So today we will focus on sensory touch tools service, but let's take it step by step. So what is inclusive theater? Inclusive theater is defined as the form of artistic expression that includes artists of all colors, genders, races, religions, nationalities, and ages who are experiencing disability or not, having as their main ideological approach the equal participation and integration of all people without exclusions in art and consequently in society. The inclusive theater approach, besides offering inclusion and participation, aims to enhance accessibility offer on and off the stage, raising awareness of rights issues while serving art and inclusion at the same time. So, theater accessibility consists of two main categories and includes all the factors that are connected to physical and content accessibility. Physical accessibility is about making the theater space accessible and friendly. For example, wheelchair accessible entrances, exits, hallways, bathrooms, dressing rooms, dynamic seating, etc. While content accessibility is for allowing equal access to the theater experience by providing services such as sign language interpretation, closed captioning, audio description, touch sensory tours, and sensory friendly performances. So in case you would like to discuss a bit more about one of those services, I would be happy to contribute in the discussion afterwards. Two of the most well-known approaches for defining disability are the social and the medical models of disability. In human-computer interaction, the medical model of disability has been the most dominant one, following the tendency of designing and delivering products for non-disabled people and trying then to adapt the same technology for people experiencing disability only after the delivery of the final product. The human-computer interaction, though, has started to change, asking who is involved in the research, in which way, and how we reduce the risk of creating vulnerability through research when working with and for specific groups. As Mankoff put it, the problem of following the medical model of disability is the assumption that people facing disability are people who need help and assistance. Our approach is based on the social model of disability, as described by Oliver in the book Politics of Disablement, which recognizes only one type of disability, the disability of the societies, to serve all the citizens with equity. And as I would not have the opportunity to present something today, if I was not collaborating with such an amazing group of artists, I will take some minutes to present them to you. So we chose to work with the Thema Inclusive Professional Theatre Ensemble. The Thema Ensemble was founded in 2010 as a professional inclusive theatre group for people experiencing disability or not, operating in Athens, Greece. Their target was to fill the void that existed in the sector of professional training and career-oriented approaches for people experiencing disability that are actively involved in the performing arts. Its members are professional members, performers, registered in the Greek Actors Association, the governing body of all performance in Greece. And ISON is the first inclusive education product project for artistic expression in Athens, founded by Thema and the inclusive dance group EXIS. So, this work took place in Greece, where accessibility of built infrastructure and content is a matter of serious concern. The lack of funding and relevant legislation prevents inclusion with equity or independent living for many people experiencing disability. The Hellenic Greek Parliament voted for the adoption of the United Nations Convention on Disabled Rights only in September 2017, although for European Union it was into force since 2011. This vote took place just a few months after the able-bodied requirement for access to higher level drama education by the Greek Ministry of Culture was removed, because till then there was this requirement. Till February 2017 there was a requirement saying that in order to have the right to be educated, to be an actor, you should be able-bodied. Yes, so yeah, this is the wow factor. It was the same for me. So this removal was a consequence of actions that Greek activists groups were conducting for a series of years. So the timeline of my work with the group begins with one meeting back in 2019, which granted to myself access to the rehearsals for ethnographic research. During the lockdowns, as the rehearsals are moving from the physical to the digital space, my transparent research role shifts to an expert in technology role. As the group is trying to find ways to keep their activities going while avoiding the operations in the physical space, two ideas were born. The first one was about the incorporation of the Theater Touch Tour service, but through technology. And the second is moving their performances into the virtual space. So, despite their name, Touch Sensory Tours are a multisensory service that aims to provide blind or visually impaired individuals with insights into the props that are used, actors' clothing, and stage's appearance. This includes tours of the stage and utilizing other senses such as smell when plot relevant, thus accommodating some of the needs of blind, deaf theater goers. What Touch Tours are trying to provide is to provide the experience of everything that cannot be perceived through the visual element. Touch sensory tours can benefit by research can benefit not only people experiencing disability, but are beneficial also for other people. I will use a very quick video to do a short recap and present the methodology I followed. The video is available online as unlisted, so in case you would like to watch it with subtitles, please let me know. And if you find something nice in the methodology, just pick it up and we can discuss it in any detail you want after the we finish the presentation.
Our approach is based on the social model of disability. That's two services are offered by theater venues that offer the service of audio description during their performances to create stimuli that substitute for the visual arts for the blind and visually impaired members of the audience through the sense of touch. Our research project was initiated by the draft research to provide ourselves an opportunity to meet and understand better the team. After identifying what is equally important both for us from a research perspective and for the team, we conducted a focus group with them to identify their needs and exchange thoughts. Before holding the research workshop, we prepared a bag with materials that can be used for DIY creations, and we asked participants to create something based on the things said during the ethnographic research and the ideas expressed during the photo. The creations were presented by their creators in the first part of the research workshop, while in the second part of the workshop, the participants experienced a low-level prototype developed for the digitization of Touch Tools based on data gathered during the previous research activities with the team and were asked to reflect on their experience. The prototype system consisted of 3D printed and other objects that were connected with a Raspberry Pi through conductive materials, targeted to provide a diversity of stimuli to the participants. Our poster presents a fact.
Enough. Okay. I think it was now. So, our initial aim was to understand if there is a point of taking such a service that is usually conducted by the performance in the physical space with their physical presence, and incorporate technology in it. So we really wanted to see if there is a point in it, or if we were just excited on doing something new. So during the focus group, we understood that the added value that the touch sensory tools will bring in the accessibility services currently offered was significant in the minds of all the participants. Some of them were particularly worried about letting other people touching them or their clothes or their faces. Amongst the reasons for that was the fear of COVID and the fact that some of the actors might feel uncomfortable with close contact with strangers due to social interaction anxiety. Other than anxiety, the sense and the experience connected to touch were also examined as from an artistic perspective, because touch, as the performance and the artist shared was, is a type of interaction, and its existence depends on the artistic frame. Moreover, all the actors mentioned that the time in which usually the touch and sensory tours are taking place, usually 1 hour before the play starts, is important for them to calm down and concentrate in their work. All the participants had a common approach to the introduction of the touch tours in the performances of Thema, which In conclusion, is a nice addition to the audio description service they already provide in their performances. They also made clear that there is no reason for the existence of the service in a performance that does not offer the audio description service. They made clear that any attempt for inclusion should be a part of the artistic expression, and this means that there is a need for cooperation between the director, the performance, and the accessibility services experts by the first steps of the performance development. Finally, a question which are still kind of struggle to address with respect on keeping our design low cost is the element of syncretism, which is simply explained by the words of the director, who said that if you have to speak with an older person coming from a village, then the reply you will provide will have much simpler words or maybe meaning than when you would reply to someone else, which is actually the way we are using to speak by addressing our audience, I guess. Trying to sum up our findings in the fastest possible way, but keeping in mind considerations we might keep for developing a toolkit for care, I will focus on 3 points and then I will quickly move in some reflections to keep in mind when developing such designs. So, to keep this short, I will speak about the concept of semiology that came really early into the discussions as a way of representing meanings rather than describing them, thus preserving the freedom of those receiving art to consume and interpret it based on their experiences. In contrast to the traditional ways of using description in other sectors, where the balance between the depth of detail that is provided and the memory of the receiver of the information should be utilized in the best possible way, in art, the case is completely different. Regarding the methodology, the artist paid special attention to the collective experience of making. Throughout the process of creating, the members were announcing the materials they could potentially use for their creations, but always making sure that the rest of the members had whatever they need to prepare their creations in order for everyone to be satisfied. Another important element that impressed me during this engagement was that being aware that we have blind and visually impaired people amongst us, the participants were never referring to the objects they are using as it. For example, can I use this or can I use it? But instead, they were always announcing what are they doing. So can I use this long red ribbon, for example, or someone else needs it, which was a nice addition to consider, I guess. Other than this important gesture of solidarity, the participants also discussed the advantages of collaborative creation by admitting the assistance they received in unlocking their imagination and the potential that would not be available if they were creating alone. Participants acknowledged the fact that besides the personal gain of unlocking their potential through collaborative work, there were also organizational factors that were resolved due to the same reasons. As they said, for them, this was an attempt to something new, and the reason that they succeed in the completion of their task was respecting the different qualities that the team members had to offer in this process. Moreover, people said that the process of creating together as an inclusive team was a way for them to understand inclusion better and break self barriers that were previously preventing them by being open and creative, thus letting them back from broadening their spectrum of understanding, even amongst them, that inclusion is a part of their daily practices. So, for them, inclusion is not another buzzword, it's a way of experiencing life through everyday practices. Our gatherings were initiated in ways that would allow us to learn and understand ourselves as a group and evaluate our common needs in order to be able to serve them and reassure that everyone is perceiving the same experience. This was a continuous pattern followed in each and every step of the procedure, because in this community, inclusion is a prerequisite. The same pattern emerged every time, almost as a ritual, as it was adapted to the community we were shaping with the participants. Every engagement was initiated by people seated in random spots, spacing the most of the times a circle, but leaving always enough space in between us to let wheelchair users choose the spot in which they feel more comfortable and not the space that remains available. In gatherings where blind and visually impaired people were joining us, we were starting by introducing ourselves in a way that will enhance the experience for all of us. For example, we were announcing next to whom we are sitting, and it was a very special element on the way that we were introducing ourselves. So we were describing ourselves like, hello, I'm Alexandra, I have long curly dark hair, I have blue eyes, white skin, I'm not fat, I'm not thin. Something like this, which I personally find as a really nice activity because besides of being a great icebreaker activity, it was nice because I feel that it is revealing something for the way that we understand ourselves from the first second that we are meeting someone. So this introduction was consisting of a small introductory speech, usually conducted by the director, following the ritual I just described to you. The point here is that in the same way that disability comes in different shapes and sizes, so does inclusion and care. Thus, the practices shall be followed from time to time differ, but our understanding is that if the community keeps the same goal in their mind, then our experience says that the adaptation to the new setting comes quite easy and fast. So, for the participants, the use of accessibility services in every form of their artistic expression, besides creating inclusion, is a way of making people realize the absence of the services in other venues, and as they put it, make the services known to people and thus create a need. So for them it was much more important to create the need for the introduction of touch tours than just providing touch tours. It is important to for them to enact activism with a unique and situated approach. Their perception of creating impact is situated in the current socio-political situation, as they highlight the importance of knowing the audience that will experience the performance is important. Their target is not to create performances that are dedicated to disability, but instead advocate for the disabled rights through actions and their existence in the performance, because impairment is a part of their identity, disability is a part of their daily experiences, and art is their passion and their profession. I think that this approach aligns with our work here, and that for the design of such toolkits, we need to develop not just a new design perspective, but also come up with ways that our designs can apply pressure for affecting policy and legislation. Reflecting upon my research with them ensemble and relevant work in human-computer interaction sector, disability studies, and grassroots innovation, I think this design should have the following characteristics. So I kept the implication for design relatively broad, so we could use them for designing either art, technology, or social innovation activities. All in all, I think that those designs should be inclusive, and by inclusive in this case, we refer to designs that will support equity in experience as per our collaborators' need for systemic change. As Paul Hill put it, systemic changes are by definition changes that target the way that the system currently operates, thus to its structure, and this is the reason that they are characterized by ambiguity. Theater and activisms are strongly connected to emotions and amongst each other at the same time. Thus, we are being led into thinking that the creation of an experience is connected with a fine balance between the information that is being communicated, the surrounding environment, and the senses that are being involved. We argue that equity in experience is a cornerstone for letting people decide where they stand, both in art and in socio-political life, by having the freedom to take this decision through their own unique interpretations. Second, situational. Performance of them declare themselves as advocates of the social model of disability, while they highlight the importance of taking into account the context in which you advocate. In their perspective, the lack of context when creating art or other actions dedicated to audiences will either reduce their success or could be the reason for their failure. For them, incorporating touch tools in their accessibility services is more of a statement than just an introduction of a new service, as they are aware of the Greek reality. In other words, their context. If we further our understanding of their approach, we can assume that this realization also changes the metrics which will characterize the system as successful. In case the initial aim was providing just touch tools, the success of the system would be defined by a combination of the blind visually impaired people that experienced the system and their opinion about the perceived experience. While in this case, the system is designed as a means of activism. So the aforementioned success factors are still important, but we should add up to them with the short-term metrics, such as how many people in total experienced the system, what their perception was, what this means to the perceived experience, how many of them were blind or visually impaired, and how their views are different from the rest of the people, and the long-term metrics. As above, the discourse around the system, how it was communicated to a broader audience, how many venues will incorporate the service after its introduction, and if the system the system's introduction contributed to the systemic change they are willing to bring through the introduction. We argue that the design of systems aiming to contribute to broader society should be aware of the current socio-political situation and informed by it to establish their own factors of success. Respectful. The group, through their experiences, described that knowing the societal context is useful as it keeps their expectations grounded. During our discussion, they explained that although there are a lot of different groups in Greece fighting for disability rights, some of them, by ignoring the lack of knowledge of the Greek society about disability, end up intimidating people, that those same people, if approached with respect, could end up being allies of the disability movement. Thus, we need to take into account the cultural context in which a system is being developed. By educational, in this case, we attempt to go a step beyond traditional education and make a point for educating through inclusion. In other words, what I want is to call the community to avoid ad hoc solutions for some people and instead develop one solution that will make the people to cooperate and meet each other through or around it. Innovative, as it is important to think that such toolkits are being designed for spaces of a relatively low financial capacity, it is important to keep in mind that those solutions, systems, methodologies, art, I don't know, should be low cost and easy to be incorporated by the groups and thus leading to their adoption. Finally, provocative, prompted by our group's opinion that in art there is no need for accuracy but a need of finding ways to engage with a wide range of audiences and create unique experiences for each member separately, we reflect on ways that this idea could be beneficial for designing for inclusion, care, and activism. We believe that as such double scope services is still in the initial design stage, the freedom of utilizing inaccuracy and ambiguity is an opportunity for provocation, since it will assist the constant reevaluation and development of the designs while utilizing the ambiguity of them to invite the curiosity of people and consequently to their use. Although in compliance with our call for respectful design, we support that in such sensitive topics connected to human rights, provocation should be targeting changing people's behavior but be extremely focused on eliminating any possible discomfort. And finally, for the cases of care, before proceeding to a discussion, I would like to add that based on all the discussion we had yesterday about defining care, I was wondering who receives this care? To whom are we targeting? To which community are we targeting? And then if we design a toolkit for providing care, then how we will receive care also as a community? So how we can build all of those tools and mechanisms that will allow care to be, you know, like recycled in a way. So I think this was by my side. All the comments, all the feedback is really welcome by my side, either positive or negative. Believe me, it's gonna be amazingly useful for me. So please feel free to reflect, judge or approve, whatever. I'm really curious about the discussion and I would and if you want to go a bit more deep in something that I mentioned, but I didn't go deeper, also feel free to to initiate this. Thank you.